This is All India Radio. In the program Spotlight, we now bring you a discussion on regime change in Cuba. The participants are Rangaraj Vishwanathan, former diplomat, and Simran Sodhi, journalist.
Today we are discussing the change that has taken place in Cuba, with Raul Castro announcing that he is resigning as the Cuban Communist Party leader, which eventually ends his family's 6 decades in power. The move, which was expected, also ends the era of former leadership by him and his brother Fidel Castro, which began with the 1959 revolution. Ambassador Vishwanathan, when you see this change happening in Cuba, how do you look at this? Do you feel that this is now the end of an era and the end of what we saw, a very powerful phase with both the Castro brothers, and there was this revolution which was there since 1959? Do you feel that with Raul Castro now stepping down, there would be a fundamental change in Cuba, or do you feel it is not going to change so much?
A planned change, not a historic change, is not going to create a disruption or a transformation or a revolution. It is all pre-planned. Of course, the name of Castro won't be there in formal official titles, but this Miguel Díaz-Canel, who has taken over as the chief of the Communist Party, he has been trained and groomed by the Castros over the last 5 years or so. Although he was born after the revolution in 1960 and belongs to a totally different generation from the revolutionary generation of Castros, he has been trained and the Castros have confidence in him that he is not going to upset the system like Gorbachev did in Russia. So it is as a known and trained and a person of trust and confidence of the Castros. So I don't expect any significant changes as long as Raul Castro is behind the scenes. He doesn't have titles, but he is still around.
Ambassador Vishwanathan, do you feel that the philosophy of socialism, communism, thing which will continue to rule Cuba, as you said, Raul Castro will remain behind the scenes, there might be a slight change, or we might see the beginning of a movement where you move away from the socialism, communism ideals? It's not going to change much, and Cuba will continue to hold whatever philosophy it has held for such a long time.
Well, it has been proven in history that 100% pure socialism and communism, or for that matter even 100% capitalism, cannot survive. So they need to adapt, they need to change, they need to reinvent. We have cases like Russia, we have China, we have Vietnam, and of course we have an exceptional case of North Korea, which is totally different. The Cubans have learned from Russia that you open up suddenly and you lose control, and the opponents of the revolution would take advantage, and the Cubans in Florida and the U.S. administration would be merciless, like they have been with Russia. At the same time, they have learned positive elements from China, from Vietnam, and I would say even Singapore. You don't need elections, voting, proper democracy. Like, Singapore is flourishing, and it is not a proper democracy. Now, China has unleashed the entrepreneurship of the people, allowing them to make money, become rich, and live a good material life without changing the political system. And this is being followed by Vietnam also. So the Cubans have studied these, the negative example of Soviet Union and the positive example of China, Vietnam, and Singapore. And they are preparing to gradually open up and transition. But the only thing is, you know, they are a poor country and this system doesn't allow them to prosperity in immediate way. So they are struggling. They don't have natural resources. And earlier, their pattern was, their main problem, apart from the internal system, was the United States, which sort of kept Cuba poor and isolated by the sanctions, which was ruthless. Now, they survived with the support of Soviet Union. But when the Soviet Union collapsed, then Chavez came to their rescue. And Chavez gave them petroleum and money and material and moral support that continued, which is being continued by Maduro also. But Venezuela is in much deeper trouble than Cuba now. So that window is also closing and it has become uncertain. And without the external support and the limited scope for internal reforms, I guess Cuban people will continue to face challenges, problems of food, problems of consumer goods in the coming years.
Mr. Vishwanathan, when we speak of China and to some extent even of Singapore, do you feel that when we look at China and Singapore, we are also then looking at the absence of a lot of freedom, like the freedom of speech and expression, the controls on media, the controls on social media? How do those things then come into play? So how does one grow economically but keeping the liberties of the individual also intact? That not be a challenge? While we look at the positives, this would also be the negatives going forward for Cuba.
But Cuba is different. Cuba is part of Latin America, where people are more fun-loving and more relaxed and more into... Cubans are very talented people in music and dance and literature, sports, even science and technology. They have advanced technology in certain niche areas of medicine and biotechnology. Right now, they are also developing vaccines for COVID. And our company called Biocon has got joint venture with Cuba, using Cuban technology for producing biotech products. So there is this particularity of Cuban people, which is totally different from the Chinese. But generation of Cubans have been brainwashed, indoctrinated, and they have lived in the strict, rigid communist system. So mentally, they have also been conditioned. One doesn't know if the new generation will sort of get a fire in the belly and rise up against them. But I don't expect it in the next few years. Maybe after Raul Castro dies, maybe after another decade or so, there could be changes.
Mr. Vishwanathan, when we talk of Cuba, one of the important relations that Cuba has always shared is with the U.S., and it hasn't been a great relationship. We have seen that when Fidel Castro was in power, the United States and Cuba, they were constantly at loggerheads. We did see some improvement and thaw in ties when Obama became president, and there was this softening of ties, and Obama also went to Cuba. We saw President Trump then taking the step back again and reimposing the embargo. Do you expect that under the new U.S. President, President Biden, do you feel that this could go back to the Obama time when ties between Cuba and U.S. will be less confrontational and this might ease things for Cuba a little bit?
Whatever Obama and Biden had achieved earlier, he reversed everything. But now Biden, who was involved in the Obama's opening to Cuba, he is in power. So the expectation is that, yes, he is definitely going to reverse the extremist policies of Trump. But the only thing is, there has not been any significant statement about opening to Cuba. Obviously, they have other priorities of China, Russia, so many other issues. So Cuba has not been in the radar of the Biden administration. But surely things will ease, and Obama has admitted the mistake of United States in suppressing Cuba with the unfair and unjust sanctions and the isolationist policy and so many covert and overt programs to assassinate Fidel Castro and harm the country. He had admitted the mistake, and it was a correction needed on the part of United States. And that correction, which was initiated during Obama's time, I guess it would be put in motion sooner rather than later by the Biden administration. And the Cubans, of course, would welcome any opening from the United States. They are desperate.
Do you also feel, Ambassador Vishwanathan, it is a generational change? The generation which saw Fidel Castro come to power and the revolution take place, today the majority of Cubans are born after that. People are maybe not that drawn towards socialism as they were during that time. Do you feel that subtle shift, that generational shift will lead to also maybe a softening of bilateral ties somewhere?
Cubans, they no longer have a live by their staple diet of revolution, socialism or death, those kind of slogans. They are open and they see what's happening around the world. They have greater exposure and their mindset is different, as you said. So this would also accelerate Cuba's own gravitation towards United States and to the world in general.
Ambassador Vishwanathan, we've also seen that Cuba, when it comes to the fields of education and healthcare, and you were also referring to its participation in the development of the corona vaccine, we have seen that Cuba actually excels when it comes to education, especially healthcare. Do you feel that this is also an outcome of the way the state has grown?
Certainly. Healthcare are two sectors in which are a kind of poster achievements of Cuba. Healthcare for everyone and high literacy rate. And in healthcare, they have not only done well for themselves, but have also gone outside and punched above their weight in providing medical education and healthcare for the rest of the world. Like, they have trained thousands of doctors from Latin America, and even some Indians have gone there for medical education. Once I remember, the Cuban vice minister was on a visit to India and he suddenly fell sick, and we admitted him to Gangaram Hospital. And guess what? The doctor who came to see the vice minister spoke perfect Spanish. He had gone to Cuba on a scholarship. So like that, the Cubans have provided free medical education to thousands of students, especially from Latin America and to other parts of the developing world. And they also sent their health workers, doctors, to many countries, to disaster zones. Like, they even sent doctors to Italy at the height of COVID issue last year. And so this is part of their, like we talk about vaccine diplomacy, theirs is the healthcare diplomacy, and they have been successful. And they also provide the training in, even in sports. Like, I think even in India, we had quite a few trainers from Cuba for some of our athletes. So there are certain niche areas in which they have made great achievements.
Ambassador Vishwanathan, we've seen that in Cuba, the tourism sector has always been one of the country's healthy sectors, which has brought in people and money. But we've seen that because of the coronavirus pandemic, this has practically shut down Cuba's tourism sector and had caused an 11% economic contraction last year. The crisis has also triggered food shortages, which have brought back memories of the early 1990s. And we've also seen, because of this food shortage, there have been calls for more political freedom in Cuba. Do you feel that all these factors will somehow get together and make Cuban leaders maybe move a little faster in opening the economy? Or do you still predict that we will see a more gradual opening of Cuba, and this is going to take a while before we see a significant shift in Cuba?
The Cubans have lived with the crisis one after other from the revolutionary days, from 1950. They have survived, and they have great capacity and resilience to suffer through misery and survive. And like, but when the Soviet Union collapsed, they didn't expect. So that was a shock. They survived it. They have also great capacity for sacrifice besides resilience. So I don't think this suffering and the problems and challenges now are anything new or in greater scale than what they had faced in the past.
Ambassador Vishwanathan, if you look back since 1959 and see first Fidel Castro and then Raul Castro, how would you look at this era when we've seen very powerful, very charismatic figure of Fidel Castro with his cigar and, you know, as the leader of Cuba, then his brother? How do you sum up this era for the present generation?
A bunch of youngsters taking a boat and from Mexico to Cuba and overthrowing a government with a large military force. That was sensational. And then afterwards, the Bay of Pigs and all the American interventions overt and covert, you know, the way Cuba survived, defended itself, and then went on the attack, that was dramatic. The Cuban Revolution was an iconic revolution, a historic revolution. And in the history of the world and for Latin America, they proved to the world that a small, vulnerable country can withstand the coercive power of a big bully with strength, with cleverness, with the diplomacy. In the world history, it's the Cuban Revolution and Fidel Castro who would remain as something memorable, something of an inspiration, although that was a different time.
And with this, we will bring today's discussion to an end. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
You were listening to a discussion on regime change in Cuba. The participants were Rangaraj Vishwanathan, former diplomat, and Simran Sodhi, journalist. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio.